JoJo is a series I'm currently going through a bit of a phase with, and instead of making 1,000 videos about JoJo like an obsessed weirdo, I'm gonna just make a few videos about JoJo so I can get it all out of my system. I've thought about doing this to a few other anime series I've watched, like One Piece, Hunter x Hunter, Fullmetal Alchemist, and maybe future series I haven't watched yet but are still on my radar, like Evangelion, Ashita no Joe, and Kaiji. Anyway, I'm going to section off my thoughts in multiple different parts. First, I'll talk about how I got into JoJo. Then I'll talk about the series part by part, talking about the characters, settings, aesthetic, and whatever I think should be said. Then I'll talk about things outside the series, like the fan base, Araki's development as a writer and artist, and stuff like that. Also, massive spoilers for everything up to the end of part 3. My story of how I got into JoJo is probably similar to many others, especially those in the West without a deep understanding of the massive amount of popularity JoJo had prior to the anime. The way I found out about it was, of course, the memes. The Western JoJo community seems to have been founded by a clever bunch of memers who, in several strokes of genius, marketed the JoJo franchise to new fans. I was among these fans who just started randomly getting bombarded with JoJo memes and decided, "Welp, I guess I gotta watch JoJo." So let's start with part 1. As a whole, I think it's pretty good, and I can respect the work put into it, but I also think there are some things that weigh it down. But let's talk about the things that do make it good for a second. Anyone who's paying attention should realize part 1 is intended to be a baseline of sorts for the entire series. A lot of the major characters are largely straightforward in their depictions, relatively speaking, of course. This is JoJo. The straightforwardness can be seen as a bad thing, but it evokes a sort of familiarity to them, at least to me. Jonathan feels like a Superman-type hero, trying his best to be righteous. I recently started to watch Fist of the North Star, which fans would know Araki took loads of inspiration from in the beginning of JoJo, and Jonathan definitely feels like a less experienced Kenshiro. Jonathan seems like he would eventually develop to be Kenshiro, given the very different circumstances that separate the storyline of Fist of the North Star from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. Anyway, I feel myself getting attached to the main characters for the sole fact that they're all just good people, plain and simple. Except for Dio, cause fuck. Let's take this as a great opportunity to talk about Dio. Araki really put his best efforts into making Dio the worst villain possible, but I mean worst in an in-universe light. Dio was intentionally crafted as a cool, heartless megalomaniac. He has a somewhat understandable backstory, but not a sympathetic one. Even the hardships he endured shouldn't necessarily validate his villainous acts. Dio was also very menacing. He was quite intimidating, and every time he died, I kinda knew he was coming back. Also, I'd been spoiled about part 3 through memes and such. Also, in part 1, Dio was much more human, despite trying his hardest to reject his humanity. The moments were small, but it was interesting to see such things as his developing similar habits as his father and hating himself for it, and his admitting that he actually was hoping the zombies would kill Jonathan because it meant they wouldn't have to face off. He tried to cover it up, but he formed some kind of connection with his brother, and they may not have been blood brothers, and that connection may not have been real, but perhaps he may have felt the odd warmth Jonathan describes at the end. Perhaps there was that mutual phantom blood coursing through the veins of their souls. Now about the not so good. I think part 1 is a little stretched out, despite its short length. The end goal was obviously to defeat Dio, so everything else that stood in the way kind of felt like padding, even though there were things that did feel essential. The reunion with Erina felt essential, as did the Hamon training, but everything else, other than the fights with Dio, the fights on Ogre Street were not only forgettable, but they just felt like a random obstacle from out of nowhere, at least until Speedwagon joined Jonathan. The fight with Jack the Ripper also felt like padding, but there was some redemption by way of being a cool field training exercise for Jonathan. The Tarkus and Bruford fights managed to be pretty interesting, I guess. The thing about all these fights is that they all felt purely functional. Actually, that connects to what I have to say about the series as a whole, at least for part 1. I think part 1 is very functional. Like, all the cogs are there, but the least amount of heart is felt in it. It's pretty clear Araki was still developing as a writer, and many of the things that part 1 had were deliberately planned out. It also seems like part 1 was intended to actually be longer, but from the way it was structured, there really was no way to make it any longer without making it feel even more stretched out. I also believe it wasn't quite bizarre enough. There wasn't very much Araki flavor that would have made part 1 stand out even more than it did. It is pretty different from most manga, especially for the time, so it must have stood out in Japan, but to me it feels a little bit like a book I would have picked up reluctantly for a middle school English project. One thing about Jonathan is that he has a rather boring, conventional character arc. He starts out as a normal boy and grows into a gentlemanly warrior. And it feels like he completes this arc around halfway through the adventure, and from there he remains flat. And there's nothing wrong with a flat character, but the best use of a flat character is when he's surrounded by dynamic characters. And you could argue that many of the supporting characters are dynamic, but most of the time their change is pretty much immediate. And for most of the dynamic characters, it goes, they fight Jonathan once, and then,
we were bad, but now we're good.
The notable exception to this is Poco, whose arc is short, but also very inspiring. Now let's talk about the Part 1 anime. I actually read most of the manga of Part 1 before watching the anime, and I feel like I have an extra layer of appreciation for the anime that many fans in the West don't seem to have. When I first saw the intro for the first time, I actually knew exactly where certain panels took place and I knew where many of the references were immediately. The animation of the actual show was pretty good, for the most part, paying respects to the original manga in lots of different ways. I also liked how they changed the color scheme of the visuals in certain scenes, which is something Araki would do often with his colors in the covers and spreads. He often used color theory to determine what palette he should go with, to get readers to elicit the right emotional response to whatever the piece was. Although, one particular way I think the anime fell off is, in the first few episodes, Jonathan's face honestly looks horrid. Like, how the fuck do you go from this to this? It got better in the later episodes, plus they thankfully fixed his face from the earlier episodes in the Blu-ray version, which is uncensored and is actually just better overall. But honestly, I think his face could still be improved. One minor gripe is, why exactly is his hair blue in the anime? In the manga, it was usually brown, which I know what they say about the manga not having a single uniform color scheme, if Joseph's hair is brown, and Joseph was originally supposed to have a strong resemblance to Jonathan, why doesn't Jonathan have brown hair? Or maybe Joseph should have blue hair. I don't know, it's a minor complaint, and I don't really care that much.
Speaking of Joseph...
To be honest, I only read the beginning of the manga. After finishing up the Part 1 anime, I was too interested to turn off the computer I was watching it on and get the manga. From right off the bat, I knew that Part 2 was going to be way cooler than Part 1. It had a lot of things that Part 1 was missing. One of the things was a more interesting main character. A more entertaining main character. Joseph was not only funny to me, but he was also interesting to watch. He was a self-taught hamon user who was quick at reading people and always had a new trick up his sleeve. That very concept made him way more interesting. That combined with the fact that he was more of an active character, making things happen, whereas Jonathan was more of a passive character, just letting things happen. Additionally, Joseph's design was more unique in my opinion. You know the design philosophy that if a character is recognizable from their silhouette, it's a good design? Well, it's sort of proven right with Joseph, as well as actually pretty much every character since Jonathan. To me, Jonathan doesn't really have an iconic look. other than the gear he has at the big fight with Dio. And it took a while for us to get there. In part 2 and after, the look is established towards the beginning, especially with characters like Jotaro and Josuke, whose iconic outfits are seen in their first appearance. The way Araki let the story flow was also better, in my opinion. In part 1, we knew what the end goal was within the first couple chapters or episodes: defeat Dio. Essentially, everything we saw after the moment Dio puts on the stone mask was building up to the point where Jonathan beats Dio, once and for all. For part 2, we don't really know what exactly the end goal is. Oh, Straight So just got the mask. Is he the next villain? Wait, nope. Okay, Santana just awakened. He seems pretty crazy, so I guess he's the nope. This story structure is way more intriguing because it gets more difficult to guess what's gonna happen next, which makes the adventure more bizarre. Now, that's not to say the story structures where the main goal is set in stone from the very beginning is bad, because in fact some of my favorite manga of all time, such as One Piece and Hunter x Hunter, follow this. Heck, even later parts of JoJo follow this. It's just that it wasn't exactly the best for the beginning of the story that promises to be bizarre. Part 2 is also better in my opinion because not only is the protagonist more basic, but also the supporting characters are similarly less basic. Even the characters that had existed in Part 1 were different people, having grown and adapted to the changing times. Arena was no longer just the sweet girl who is the main character's love interest, which is pretty common in shonen manga and other media. Instead, she had become the strict grandmother of the wild only child. Speedwagon remains the same, only he is now even more best girl than he was before. Speedwagon was very cool to see because A, he was a descendant of a cool character from Part 1, and B, he also had a personality that was very different from the idealistic characters of Part 1. His sort of stuck-up, cocky nature clashed with Joseph, who was also kinda stuck-up and cocky, but in a much less uptight way. Lisa added a very nice ingredient to the mix as the strict teacher who intended to whip up these silly boys into shape. The new minor characters like Smokey, Suzy Q, Loggins, and Messina were cool, but not necessarily essential. They all had their roles, but they were relatively small, and they fulfilled them all well. Many people seem to think Smokey, for some reason, was meant to be Joseph's sidekick, who follow him throughout the story, sort of like Poco in Part 1, or Lean in Bat from what I've seen in Fist of the North Star. I kind of thought this too, but some seem to hold this idea against Araki, saying his absence in much of Part 2 is a plot hole, or even that he forgot he existed. People say he likely had a purpose or something, but it was abandoned. I think he had his purpose and it was served. Through Smokey, we got an interesting look at New York's JoJo. We got to see Joseph's passion for the underdog, as well as his tendency to battle. Von Stroheim also stood out to me. One thing that is pretty common in modern stories that take place during World War II is that if a Nazi appears, they are definitely evil. So I thought Stroheim was going to be just a villain and stay a villain for the entire part. I was pretty surprised when he actually proved himself as a valuable ally. I liked the sort of mutual respect they had for one another, despite the ideologies of their respective countries being so dramatically opposed. I really wonder how Japanese fans saw this rivalry, especially considering that Japan used to be allied with Germany. As for the actual villains that stay villains, I thought they were pretty engaging. Like I said earlier, I wasn't entirely sure what the in-game villain was supposed to be like, which made the story more irresistible. Early on, I was a bit afraid the villains would seem rather bland, especially in comparison with Dio, because Dio had a personal connection with Jonathan, whereas Straight So's connection to Joseph was more secondhand at best. However, this personal connection issue seemed to be sort of resolved towards the end with the Pillarmen, when they attacked Caesar and Lisa, who at that point had gotten pretty close to Joseph. Also, by the end of the time the climax was approaching, Lisa had been revealed to be Joseph's mother, and it would have been tragic if she died, never telling Joseph the truth. Another thing that I kind of feared was that the villains would be boring. From off the bat, Straight So, Santana, and the three other Pillarmen's personalities seemed to be, "Grr, I'm evil and stronger than the villain before." a slope many shonen writers struggled not to slip on. But there was more to that, specifically with Cars, Wamu, and ACDC. There was an actual dynamic to their relationships with one another, and they all had that bizarre character quirk that no one else had. However, these character quirks do seem a little bit tacked on, especially since there's no real explanation as to why they have these quirks. I'm mainly talking about stuff like Wamu's reflex for attacking people who steps in his shadow. But by and large, these things that contribute to the Pillarmen being anything other than boring is welcome. I also feel like the personal connection thing was sort of tacked on, not necessarily at the last minute, but the integration of the personal connections could have been better. I think a relatively simple issue like that would have been solved if Araki was writing a novel or something that didn't have such an aggressive schedule. That is not to say the final fight was bad. It was actually pretty exciting, much more so than Part 1's. The conclusion to Part 1's final fight was peaceful but tragic, a farewell between two brothers brought together by fate and torn apart by one's determination to defend what they thought they were destined for. Part 2's final fight was an explosive clash between beings that embody all that nature is, a god as you might call him, versus a guy with a red rock, some jokes, and sparkly breath powers. I also like the element of cosmic irony in Karza's death. He wanted to become the ultimate being and chased immortality and godhood, and he actually achieved all that. But at the same time, he also received a fate much worse than any mortal could. And that is a fantastically, cosmically ironic ending for a character, and an amazing and unique ending to the climax. Like I said earlier, I like Joseph because he was a character full of surprises. So an ending in which he attends his own funeral is nothing short of perfect for him. Also, this scene kind of brings up a few things I wanted to mention. I honestly feel like there may have been a few moments in Part 2 that cannot be described as anything other than assholes. A lot of times I ask myself, where the fuck did he get that? Where the fuck did that come from? What the fuck is this nigga doing? How, what the fuck? But at the same time, it was also really fun and truly unpredictable. You could argue that Araki sort of planned to pull things out of his ass, so to speak, and you're supposed to just roll with it and have fun. It's like a roller coaster or a haunted house or, I don't know, a wild house party. You're not supposed to know what's going to happen. Whether that actually justifies pulling solutions out of your ass is arguable at best, though. One thing that I liked about the end of Part 2 that we didn't get to have in the other parts was a view of how the other characters led their lives after the adventure. It was bittersweet. Although JoJo and the audience only knew these people for a short time, it was still bittersweet to find out how they eventually died or moved on in life. If I'm not mistaken, this was more expanded upon in the anime, and in my opinion, doing that was a very nice touch. Speaking of the anime, let's talk about it in particular. A lot of good things were thankfully brought over from the Part 1 adaptation, like the dramatic effects, the color switches, and all the tasteful and stylish bits and pieces that were peppered around in every episode to really exude that Araki flavor. Also, Joseph neither looks hideous nor retarded, which is a big plus. I really like the upbeat jazz style of the opening as well. Especially since it's kind of a nod to the time period in which jazz was very popular. I also really enjoyed the OST. Although it was not at all a match for the time period, it matched the energy of the show very well. Overall, the anime was once again very respectful and sophisticated, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I also liked the sort of teaser at the end of Part 2. Where we see Joseph as an old man, kicking the shit out of those dirty chaps, not because of Pearl Harbor, but because of a reason even more sinister.
Race mixing.
And now, on to Part 3. As basically every video about Part 3 begins, it's perhaps the most popular, both in Japan and worldwide. And for good reason. In the first three parts, Araki would add new aspects to the previous part that was lacking. Part 1 lacked, among other things, an interesting protagonist. Part 2 solved this, but it kind of felt like Araki wanted to experiment with other interesting hamon techniques, but there wasn't quite enough flexibility with hamon to do too much. Part 3 added a much-needed, crucial aspect that was inherently unique and more flexible. Stands. Stands could be, and still can be, basically whatever Araki wanted them to be, and unlike Hamon, there were fewer definitive guidelines put in place that limit the possibilities of a character having a power, technique, or whatever that is original to them. While creative Hamon abilities were showed off in the first two parts, especially part two, I think stands were much better in terms of making an interesting and distinctive fight. People say that because Hamon was essentially dropped in favor of stands, Araki forgot about Hamon. Others say that stand battles are much less interesting than Hamon battles. To both of these, I say shut the fuck up, retard.
But you're a pussy if you fight with stand because it's not actually you.
Stands are a manifestation of your soul. Your stand is a part of you. So if your stand gets hurt, then you get hurt and vice versa. So by getting into a stand battle, I say you're just as brave as a person who would be getting into a physical fight.
But Hamon is better because it's traditional.
One of the entire points of JoJo is to not be traditional. The second word in the title wouldn't be bizarre if it wasn't. But enough fake arguing with myself. Part 3 is a big departure from the first two parts in practically every sense. Part 3 followed a much more episodic angle, with a villain of the week type structure taking up most of the part. I found this pretty fun, and it reminded me of a lot of action cartoons that I used to watch as a kid. I also felt like Araki was having a lot of fun creating and portraying these characters on the page, and David Production, apparently there's no S at the end, clearly put a lot of effort recreating these moments on the screen. Some people might say that the villain of the week format is childish, especially because most of them don't build towards the greater goal of the story. I'd say this is entirely fair, but not everything has to build up to the epic conclusion. And the format does build up something. It builds up the personalities and relationships between each of the crusaders. They get to know each other and we get to know them. Also, it was nice to see some more side characters get character arcs, namely Polnareff and Iggy. In fact, it feels like Polnareff got more attention sometimes than Jotaro himself as far as character arc goes. Unfortunately, not everybody got to have their own arc. I was pretty disappointed to see how little attention Kakyoin and Avdol got, especially since I actually thought their visual character designs and stand powers were the coolest. You could probably name like 10 Jotaro or Polnareff moments without much difficulty, but if you were to name some cool Kakyoin moments, or Avdol moments, or even old Joseph moments, it'd be a little bit more difficult. Not impossible, because there are definitely moments where every crusader gets to shine, but I would have liked to see a well-rounded number of moments from every member. But you know what? Maybe I'm just mad that my favorite characters didn't live at the end. Even though not every character gets very many big moments dedicated to them, it does feel like every character gets to know each other over the course of 50 days. As someone who has ended up in a position where I got stuck with complete strangers and ended up growing a strange yet tight bond with the people there up till the time we had to say goodbye, I kind of relate. Speaking of characters, let's talk about Anne, because I don't think I have a better segue into my thoughts on her. A lot of people say Araki forgot about Anne. To say he forgot about her is sort of misattributing what I still think is a valid criticism. She did have a point in which she had a legit send-off, so she didn't just disappear, but I think the reason people bother talking about her is she didn't seem to have a purpose. There doesn't seem to be any reason for her to have been brought into the series. If you removed her entirely from the series, nothing would have changed, except maybe the strength fight. Araki didn't forget her, she was just pointless. That's what people should be saying about her. Now, it's entirely possible that Araki had plans for her, but just scrapped them at some point because he couldn't execute them, or maybe he couldn't meet deadlines or something. Or he just realized no one actually likes the child side character with no powers who follows around the main cast for one reason or another. So yeah, Araki didn't forget about her, she was just useless. Next, I want to talk about the villains. In retrospect, only a handful of them stand out in any particular way to me. But in the moment, while I was watching each fight unfold, I don't remember being particularly bored during a villain or a fight. And the fights I remember liking a lot are all the ones everyone talks about anyway, so I don't want to waste too much time talking about them. My favorite fights are probably the Darby fights, the Oingo and Boingo fights, the Whole Horse fights, and the Nduel fight. If you watch a lot of JoJo videos, you've probably heard a lot about these fights, but those really set themselves apart for reasons unique to each one. The Darby fights are interesting because it was something JoJo and the gangs were limited in their choices, and the stakes were raised to an extreme high in simple games, games that were somehow more tense than the action-packed punch fest of all the other fights. The Oingo Boingo fights were hilarious in my opinion because of their sheer incompetence. Also, we got to see a bit of slice of life to the Crusaders. We got to see them hanging out together, which I thought was pretty nice to see. I always like seeing characters in action adventure series just hanging around when they don't have to be saving the world or whatever. I liked Whole Horse because he had a unique personality and some funny characterization. He's the type of dude you just wanted to see return. Most of the villains just had a stand that was just interesting enough to hold your attention for a few chapters, or an episode if you're an anime-only plebeian, and had a personality that was just, oh, I serve Dio and I will kill you. I think overall, the 9 Glory God fights are probably the best ones in the series, though that's probably hardly an original opinion. They either had higher stakes, more interesting stand powers, funnier antics, or better fight choreography, or a combination of all of those. Now, all of these villains and their fights were brought to life very well in the anime, but I think one thing that could have been improved was the color. If you compare an iconic digitally colored panel from the manga to a shot in the anime, the primary thing you'll probably see lacking is the color. The vibrant manga panel colors seem significantly muted in the anime. Of course, this wasn't always the case, since, like with other part before, and since, there are cool moments where the color palette swap and we get all kinds of lively blues and reds and purples and greens. Now, let's talk about the ending. Much like the ending to Part 2, Part 3's final fight was tense, wild, over the top, and intuitive. After the fight, we had a nice aftermath scene or two, and then a conclusion that really hits you in the feels. I think this was probably how Araki figured out his basic ending template, so to speak. The fight was really fun to watch, but after Jotaro first began approaching Dio, it wasn't as serious as the other fights that kinda had been leading up to it. The Vanilla Ice fight was super intense, and you could really feel the height of the stakes. Vanilla Ice and the terrifying stand, Cream, was really dealing the damage, and I figured that Dio was gonna be even more brutal. In the end, however, Vanilla Ice actually ended up killing more Crusaders than Dio. That's not to say the Dio fight was bad, it's just that the Vanilla fight was more serious. I liked both for different reasons, but at the end of the day, the idea of the deranged, obsessed psychopath who would stop at nothing to kill anyone who mocked his crush was honestly scarier than Dio, who we basically already knew everything about. The bizarre fun of the final fight between Dio and Jotaro is not only self-evident, but also somewhat overstated. I don't usually like fights that last more than a few episodes or chapters, looking at you, Goku and Frieza, but oftentimes stuff gets boring, and or the author will pull random things out of nowhere and the suspension of disbelief will dissipate. But this fight mostly did things where I was able to keep my disbelief suspended for a good long time. Also, when I first started seeing stuff like Jotaro and Dio flying, I was just like, yeah, Hamon Beats probably got a video on this, so I'll just go with it. But with Jotaro's sudden ability to stop time, it was and still is pretty iffy to me. People have tried to rationalize it, but it hasn't quite been so satisfying to me. But I suppose the point was to just roll with it, which honestly you could say is one of the unspoken core themes of the series. Another core theme in JoJo is fate. It sometimes seems like fate is a character, or possibly even that Araki is a character in JoJo, acting in the series through fate. It seems as though fate is aligned with the Joestars, and whenever someone tries to step out of line, so to speak, thinking they can play God and control fate, there's always a Joestar there to smack them down, bringing them back to humility. The ending to JoJo Part 3 has a distinct finality to it. We finally close the book on the menaces that have been terrorizing the Joestar bloodline. The mysteries of the stone masks, the vampires, and of course, Dio. The ending to it felt like a sort of jumping off point, where the series could have ended here and nothing would have felt very wrong about it. And if I'm not mistaken, JoJo was originally planned to be a trilogy, which makes sense. However, as we all know, JoJo's inspiration and creativity was not going to let him put down the pen here, and after Stardust Crusaders came... Sorry guys, this video was originally intended to go over literally every single thought on every single part of JoJo, after which I'd share some of my thoughts on some things outside the core franchise, like the fanbase and the memes, and maybe after that I'd consider making a follow-up with all the spin-offs and games and stuff, until I could eventually say I had said everything that could possibly be said about JoJo. Unfortunately, the page I'm reading of this script is page 16, and there's still more pages worth of little bullet printed outlines of other parts. Also, there's the higher chance that I'm probably going to get more watch minutes if I split the video up, so oy vey. Be sure to like this video, share, subscribe, hit the bell, and have a great day in our crazy, noisy, bizarre town.